often do you see a TV show blamed for murder? A year ago, in a court of law, a 24-year-old man named Jonathan Schmitz was convicted of second-degree murder. But in the court of public opinion, it seemed like the Jenny Jones show took the blame. That tragic encounter has changed Jones' life, but not in the way you might think. Tonight, she's telling her side of the story for the first time. But this is no confession. This is Jenny Jones as she's always been, surviving the tough times with few apologies.
Jenny,
Jenny Jones has made more than 1,000 entrances like this, always to enthusiastic applause. But today it's different. She's talking to a Dateline audience.
You're nervous. A little bit. Or a lot.
A lot.
Yeah. Nervous because after 2.5 years of withering criticism, she's finally addressing head-on the critics who say she and the show were somehow to blame when one of her guests was shot and killed by another 3 days after a taped appearance.
The headlines were, you know, that they ambushed him. If I heard that word ambush one more time, I want to just scream because I knew that it wasn't.
It wasn't just the media. You did hear from the general public.
I remember one letter that I got in the mail that said, "You've got blood on your hands."
Now she writes about the murder in her new autobiography. But in fact, Jenny Jones' My Story would be quite a tale even without those chapters.
What's your earliest memory?
My very first memory, I was probably 3 or 4. And it was of my father throwing a table at my mother. And I didn't know why he hated her or why he treated her like that. I just remember that he spit on her. And the spit was kind of sitting in her hair. It's my first memory.
Are there any good ones?
There are a few good ones, not a lot.
Born Janina Stronsky in Palestine after World War II, she was the second child of Polish refugees. Her father, who survived both German and Soviet imprisonment, was a hard and sometimes brutal man who brought his family to Canada and built a successful business from Jenny's mother's skills as a seamstress. But he probably met his match in his willful daughter, Jenny.
Your book's pretty candid. You did a little shoplifting and a lot of drinking.
Mm-hmm. A lot of drinking. I actually cut school a few times just to get drunk. There were times when I don't remember coming home.
How old?
13, 14.
She was a truant and a runaway, working as a waitress and living in a transient apartment for a month until she was caught and sent home. She was 11. But she never stopped looking for a way out, and she knew the instant she found it.
We were hanging out with some musicians one time, and I said, "Well, everybody, it looks like fun. You always want to try to play the drums." And so I said, "Let me try that." And he gave me the sticks, and I played something. He said, "Wow."
What'd you play?
And I could actually do that. And a lot of people, want to try it? She loves you,
yeah, yeah. After 3 months self-taught on Beatles records, she dropped out of high school and at 17 hit the road. It took her eventually to Las Vegas, where she and her all-girl band, the Cover Girls, were a successful lounge act. Followed by a 2-year stint singing backup for Wayne Newton. Followed by an improbable stab as the rare female in stand-up comedy. She could have competed with Jay Leno for the title Hardest Working Person in Showbiz. And unless he was making his own costumes too, Jenny Jones might have won.
Thank you very much. I am honored to be the first female comic on this series.
In 1986, she did win. This was the first of 6 appearances on Star Search and the first of 6 mini dresses she made herself.
I want to talk about my favorite subject tonight, men. I think sometimes men are confused about women and what it is we actually look for in a man. So I'm going to tell you what I find attractive on a man. Cash.
Is that you?
Yeah, and if you're going to talk about the hair, I wouldn't go there if I were you.
What's the deal with the hair?
Well, if you talk about my hair, I'm going to talk about your hair, okay?
I never went that direction.
Jenny Jones!
Despite the dress, the hair, the lounge lizard look, she went all the way and won the $100,000 top prize, riding a rocket that promptly fizzled.
Oh, God. My career was pretty much over. I couldn't get a manager. I couldn't get an agent. I wasn't going to make it. I had been branded a Vegas act, which for television was not good.
By now desperate for success and broke again, she had an inspired idea. A stand-up act for women only. She called it Girls Night Out, and it was a sold-out phenomenon coast to coast.
They were scalping tickets. The press was trying to get in. I wouldn't let them in because I didn't want male camera people in the room.
The media discovered her, and overnight, she was the host of a syndicated TV talk show. It started with light comedy, but faltering in the ratings, the Jenny Jones Show quickly remade itself into an example of just about everything critics hate about daytime TV.
Baby, you know what you need to do? Drop that zero and get you a hero.
The ratings skyrocketed. Jenny Jones, who had been broke, soon became a multimillionaire.
Lizzie, looking for me?
Okay, I'm going.
When Dateline visited the show earlier this month, the topic was, I hate to be rude, but you look like a dude. It was a makeover show featuring female guests who looked and dressed like men.
Yes.
Yes. One of them, I'm Jean. I'm your first one.
Ready, Jenny? Oh, my God, Jenny. Ah!
Those people, they are an interesting subset of Americana, the people that appear on the daytime talk shows to talk about their affairs and their family troubles and their issues. And
but you're right, they are Americana. They really are American people. They come from where I come from, so if people have a problem with the guests, they should have a problem with me because we come from the same place.
On March 6, 1995, one of the two shows she taped that day was about same-sex secret crushes. It was the most talked about show she would ever do, even though it never aired.
Now, which of these ways would you choose to reveal your secret crush on someone? A, would you write that person a letter? B, would you tell the person in private in case he rejects you? Or C, would you tell that person that you're gay and you hope he is on national television?
32-year-old Scott Amador was a bartender and Army veteran who lived near Detroit. A few days before the taping, he heard that the Jenny Jones Show was looking for guests who had secret crushes on people of the same sex. He and a friend, Donna Riley, called the show because Amador was attracted to a mutual acquaintance, 24-year-old Jonathan Schmitz. The only person not in on exactly what would happen was Schmitz himself.
Hi, John. Did you think Donna had the crush on you?
Did I? No, we're good friends.
Well, guess what? It's Scott that has the crush on you.
You lied to me.
Before we talk, take a look at, we'll show a little playback of what Scott said about you, John. Take a look at that monitor
right here,
down there.
I got a pretty big hammock in my yard, and I thought about tying them up to my hammock.
And?
Well, it entails like whipped cream and champagne, stuff like that.
Three days later, Jonathan Schmitz spent $300 on a 12-gauge pump-action shotgun and went to Amador's home. Minutes later, he called 911 and said he'd shot someone who had humiliated him on national television.
Calm down, okay?
Why can't you acknowledge the possibility that John Schmitz experienced humiliation here on your show?
Because
whether you meant to set it up that way or not.
I was here. It didn't happen. Did you have any idea that he liked you this much?
Jenny Jones says Schmitz reacted gracefully to Amador's secret crush. And she says Schmitz had been told his secret crush could be a man or a woman, though Schmitz responded that he wanted it to be a woman.
He could have chosen not to appear. He could have told us last minute he didn't want to do it. He suspected it was a man. He suspected it was Scott, the man who did have the crush, who he later murdered. He suspected that man. He asked him the night before. He said, Scott, is it you? And Scott said, what if it is? And Jonathan said, that's fine, I'm going to go for it. I don't care what anybody thinks, I'm going to go for it. That was his answer.
Although Schmidt's family testified he was devastated after the taping, Jenny Jones says the three of them left the studio together.
They went back to the airport in the same limousine. They flew back to Detroit on the same flight. They weren't booked on the same flight. Jonathan asked Scott to change his flight to fly back with him. This is so important for me to get this. People don't know this.
And she says that later that same night back in Detroit, Schmitz, Donna Reilly, and Scott Amador went drinking together at this bar.
They closed the bar. They went to Donna's house. According to Donna's testimony, Jonathan suggested a threesome with the three of them. How could this be a humiliated man if he was, if anything, pursuing the relationship?
What neither Jenny Jones, nor her producers, nor her studio audience knew was that Jonathan Schmitz had a history of psychiatric problems and multiple suicide attempts.
When you learned that John had a history of suicide attempts, for instance, did that catch you off guard? Did you think, oh, maybe he shouldn't have been booked?
The people that came on the show with him were his friends. They thought he was well enough to do the show.
Whether you say you're responsible for it or not, you had a brush with tragedy. How do you go about doing your show differently as a result?
We don't do anything differently because we don't feel there was anything to change. We do the same kind of show. We check the guests out the same way that we do. We haven't changed a thing.
So you would do it again?
Absolutely. I think it's a great topic.
Until now, Jenny Jones wasn't able to answer her critics on advice of her lawyers. But a year ago, she faced a jury in the Jonathan Schmitz murder trial, better known as the Jenny Jones trial. We replayed parts of her testimony for her.
There were a total of six separate segments. Is that correct?
I don't remember.
Can you tell us what occurs on the show during those segment interludes?
If you know.
On that particular show?
Yes, on that particular show.
I don't remember.
Do you recall having conversation with your producer or associate producer regarding how they obtained guests for this show?
No.
Can you kindly describe for us what it is you discuss in that briefing?
If you can recall.
Pertaining to this show.
Oh, I have no idea.
Well, seeing it for the first time, what do you think?
Well, it makes me angry to see it, actually.
Her testimony was memorable for all she didn't seem to know about her own show, or so it appeared. In fact, though it wasn't widely reported, the judge's instructions limited the questioning to that particular taping in March of 95.
And all of these questions were asked about something that happened 2 years before then. I can't remember what I said to these people 2 years ago.
Are you charged with any production responsibility with regard to the Jenny Jones show?
No, I'm not.
This is where I'm going to quibble with you, because I think you do have a role in the production.
But his question was, are you charged with any responsibility? No, I'm not. It's my choice to be this involved. It's not my responsibility. I am not charged with that responsibility. It's something that I do on my own. That's why I answered that question that way.
Jenny Jones, remember, was not on trial, but Jonathan Schmidt's defense was that the combination of deep embarrassment and psychiatric problems caused diminished mental capacity. The jury ultimately found him guilty of second-degree murder, which is now under appeal. He's doing 25 to 50 years in prison. But several jury members later told Dateline they thought the show had been a catalyst, and each of these five thought the producers had been irresponsible.
I think that that's where the producers of the show have failed, is that they didn't properly screen the guests who were going to be appearing on the show.
Saying it could be a man or could be a woman was a lie, wasn't it?
I don't think so. I told him it could be a man or a woman.
Could it have been a woman?
No.
But you told John it could have been a woman, right?
Yes.
Isn't that a lie?
In
told him something that it couldn't have been.
Sure.
Did you ask any of the guests, including John, including Scott Amador, including Donna Reilly, if they had any mental problems?
No.
Did you care if they had any mental problems?
I would care if I knew.
Were you mad at anybody just that they maybe didn't do their job as well as they could?
No.
And it blows up in your face only?
No, because I don't think anyone at the show did anything wrong, and I didn't feel set up by anyone. Nobody was fired, nobody was demoted, because nobody did anything wrong.
Jenny Jones may yet testify in another courtroom. The family of Scott Amador has filed a $50 million wrongful death suit against the owners of the Jenny Jones show.
Scott Amador's mother complained that you had never personally sent condolences. Why not? And is it too late?
I don't think it's too late. I wanted to. Immediately, I said, let's send flowers. Let's send a note. I'd like to call her. I'd like to go to the funeral. And I was advised not to by the attorneys.
You think that was good advice?
No. Bad advice. It's a lesson to me to go with my gut, to go with my heart. It was really a personal thing more than a show-related thing, and I should have done it.
When will it all be over for you?
Well, it'll never be over. We can only get past it. I will survive this. I've survived a lot of things in my life, and I will survive it, but it'll never be the same.
Prior to the Scott Amador murder case, Jenny Jones was best known for having gone public with a very private struggle, her six disastrous surgeries for cosmetic breast implants. Because so many women with breast cancer also turn to implants, she's giving her profits for the sale of her autobiography to breast cancer research.